Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear.
Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave.
And one of them struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear.
Stop! No more of this!
Please be seated. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. When the hour came, Jesus took his place at table with the apostles. He said to them,
I have eagerly desired to share this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I shall not eat it again until there is fulfillment in the kingdom of God.
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and said,
take this and share it among yourselves. For I tell you that from this time on, I shall not drink from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes.
Then he took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, saying,
this is my body, which will be given for you. Do this in memory of me.
And likewise the cup after they had eaten, saying,
this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which will be shed for you. And yet, behold, the hand of the one who is to betray me is with me at this table. For the Son of Man indeed goes as it has been determined, but woe to that man by whom he is betrayed.
And they began to debate among themselves who would do such a deed. Then an argument broke out among them as to which one would be regarded as the greatest. He said to them,
the kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are addressed as benefactors. But among you, it shall not be so. Rather, let the greatest among you be as the youngest, the leader as the servant. For who is greater, the one seated at the table or the one who serves? Has it not always been the one seated at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. And it is you who have stood by me during my trials. And I confer a kingdom on you as my Father has conferred one on me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom. And you shall sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, Satan has demanded to sift us all like wheat. I have prayed that your own faith may not fail. And once you have turned back, you in turn must strengthen your brothers.
Lord, I am prepared to go to prison and to die with you.
I tell you, Peter, before the cock crows this day, you will three times deny that you know me.
He said to them,
"When I sent you forth without a money bag, a sack, or sandals, were you in need of anything?"
"No, nothing."
"But now, one who has a money bag should take it, and likewise a sack. And one who does not have a sword should sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you that these scriptures must be fulfilled in me. Namely, that he is being counted among the wicked. And indeed, what is being written about me is coming to fulfillment."
"Lord, look, there are two swords here."
"It is enough."
Then, going out, he went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he arrived at the place, he said to them,
Pray that you may not undergo the test."
After withdrawing about a stone's throw from them and kneeling, he prayed, saying,
"My Father, if it is possible, take this cup away from me. Still, not my will, but yours be done."
And to strengthen him, an angel from heaven appeared to him. He was in such agony, and he prayed so fervently that his sweat became like drops of blood falling on the ground. When he rose from prayer and returned to his disciples, he found them sleeping from grief. He said to them,
"Why? Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not undergo the test."
While he was still speaking, a crowd approached, and in front was one of the 12, a man named Judas. He went up to Jesus to kiss him. Jesus said to him,
"Judas, Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?"
His disciples realized what was about to happen, and they asked,
"Lord, shall we strike with a sword?"
And one of them struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear.
"Stop! No more of this!"
Then he touched the servant's ear and healed him. And Jesus said to the chief priests and temple guards and elders who had come for him,
"Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs? Day after day, I was in the temple area, and you did not seize me. But this is your hour, the time for the power of darkness."
After arresting him, they led him away and took him into the house of the high priest. Peter was following at a distance. They lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat around it, and Peter sat with them. When a maid saw him seated in the light, she looked intently at him and said,
"This man, too, was with him."
"Woman, I do not know him."
A short while later, someone else saw him and said,
"You, too, are one of them."
But Peter answered,
"My friend, I am not."
About another hour, still another insisted,
"Assuredly, this man was with him, for he is also a Galilean."
"My friend, I do not know what you are talking about."
Just as he was saying this, the cock crowed. And the Lord looked and turned to Peter and said, and Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said it to him,
"Before the cock crows today, you will deny me 3 times.
He went out and began to weep bitterly. The men held Jesus in custody, were ridiculing and beating him. They blindfolded him and questioned him, saying,
"Prophesy, who is it that struck you?"
And they reviled him and saying many other things against him. When the day came, the council of elders and the people met, both chief priests and scribes, and they brought him before their Sanhedrin. They said,
"If you are the Christ, then tell us."
"If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question, you will not respond. But from this time on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power of God."
They all asked,
Are you then the Son of God?
"It is you who say that I am."
"What further need have we for testimony? We have heard it from his own mouth."
Then the whole assembly of them arose and brought him before Pilate. They brought charges against him, saying,
"We found this man misleading our people.
He opposes the payment of taxes to Caesar
and maintains that he is the Christ, a king."
Pilate asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
"If you say so."
Pilate then addressed the chief priests and the crowds.
"I find this man not guilty."
But they were adamant and said,
"He is enticing the people with his teachings throughout Judea,
from Galilee, where he began, even to here."
On hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. And upon learning that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was in Jerusalem at that time. Herod was very glad to see Jesus. He had been wanting to see him for a long time, for he had heard about him and had been hoping to see him perform some sign. He questioned him at length, but he gave him no answer. The chief priests and scribes, meanwhile, stood by, accusing him harshly. Herod and his soldiers treated him contemptuously and mocked him, and after clothing him in resplendent garb, he sent him back to Pilate. Herod and Pilate became friends that very day, even though they had been enemies formerly. Pilate then summoned the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them,
"You brought this man to me and accused him of inciting the people to revolt. I have conducted my investigation in your presence and have not found this man guilty of the charges you have brought against him. Nor did Herod, for he sent him back to us. So no capital crime has been committed by him. Therefore, I shall have him flogged and then release him."
But altogether they shouted out,
"Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us!"
Now Barabbas had been imprisoned for a rebellion that had taken place in the city, and for murder. Again Pilate addressed them, still wishing to release Jesus, but they continued their shouting,
Crucify him!
"What evil has this man done? I found him guilty of no capital crime. Therefore, I shall have him flogged and then release him."
With loud shouts, however, they persisted in calling for his crucifixion, and their voices prevailed. The verdict of Pilate was that their demand should be granted. So he released the man who had been imprisoned for rebellion and murder, for whom they asked, and he handed Jesus over to them to deal with as they wished. As they led him away, they took hold of a certain Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country. And after laying the cross on him, they made him carry it behind Jesus. A large crowd of people followed Jesus, including many women who mourned and lamented him. Jesus turned to them and said,
"Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep instead for yourselves and for your children. For the days are coming when people will say, 'Blessed are the barren, the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed. For at this time, people will say to the mountains, fall upon us, and to the hills, cover us. For if these things are done, when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?
Now two others, both criminals, were led away with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him and the criminals there, one on his right, the other on his left. Then Jesus said,
Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
They divided his garments by casting lots. The people stood by and watched. The rulers, meanwhile, sneered at him and said,
He saved others.
Let him save himself if he is the chosen one, the Christ of God.
Even the soldiers jeered at him. As they approached to offer him wine, they called out,
If you are King of the Jews, save yourself.
Above him there was an inscription that read, This is the King of the Jews. Now one of the criminals hanging there reviled Jesus, saying,
Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us.
The other, however, rebuking him, said in reply,
Have you no fear of God? For you are the subject to condemnation. And indeed, we have been condemned, justified. The sentence we receive corresponds to our crimes. But this man has done nothing criminal.
Then he said,
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
Amen. Amen, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise.
It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. because of an eclipse of the sun. Then the veil of the temple was torn down the middle. Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
Father, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
And when he had said this, he breathed his last.
Please join me in kneeling. Please stand.
The centurion who witnessed what had happened glorified God and said,
This man was innocent, innocent beyond doubt.
When all the people who had gathered for the spectacle saw what had happened, they returned home, beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances stood at a distance, including the woman who had followed him from Galilee and saw these events. Now there was a virtuous and righteous man named Joseph, who, though he was a member of the council, had not consented to their plan of action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea and was awaiting the kingdom of God. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. After he had taken the body down, he wrapped it in a linen cloth and laid him in a rock-hewn tomb in which no one had yet been buried. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The woman who had come from Galilee with him followed behind, and when they had seen the tomb and the way in which the body was laid in it, they returned and prepared spices and perfumed oils. Then they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment.